Well, what I want to do today, as you see from the board, is to deal with two late medieval figures, Duns Scotus and William of Ockham, who represent something of a reaction against what they see as the untoward influence of Greek philosophy. Indeed, what they see as Greek determinism, the untoward influence of this on Christian thought. Duns Scotus, a Franciscan, very much concerned about Greek determinism. And so moves towards a more voluntaristic view of personality, both human and divine. Now, when I say a voluntaristic view of personality, what I'm doing is referring to the fact that on the matter of will and intellect, there are really two main alternatives that developed: voluntarism and intellectualism. The one obviously stressing the primacy of will, and the other stressing the primacy of intellect. So the question is, when one chooses to do something, Is that choice, is that decision, is that action, a result of intellect or of will free from intellectual demand, assessment, requirement? And both Scotus and Ockham read Aquinas as an intellectualist in this sense, maintaining, that is to say, that God acts in accordance with eternal forms, eternal archetypes, so that God's act of creation was not, in that sense, free from anything other than that he could choose. And in regards to human nature, that moral action, in the moral psychology of Thomas Aquinas, moral action is again governed by the intellect, what one perceives as good, and that consequently one is not free from those moral causes. So this is their concern. And the feeling is that this compromises, in the first instance, the sovereignty of God, which is saying the will of God, and compromises, in the second case, the responsibility of humans, that is to say, their freedom of choice. So, how does all this come together? Well, you may have gleaned, if you've been trying to read Duns Scotus, that there is good reason why he was called the subtle doctor. Because his writing is, if anything, more difficult to figure out than Thomas Aquinas. But I think we can get a handle on it if we go back to the overall shape of the philosophical worldview with which Thomas Aquinas has left us. Namely, the emphasis on a hierarchy of being, where each degree of being and goodness in the hierarchy is in accordance with the essential forms of things that make up the whole hierarchy of creation. That is to say, as much as this is a hierarchy without gaps and without arbitrariness, and the forms are essential in the sense that they could not be otherwise. The whole hierarchical pattern is seen as something which represents ontological necessity. It's a hierarchy of being which could not be otherwise. It's the necessary shape that being takes. Humans could not be otherwise than where they are on the hierarchy of being. Nothing could be anywhere else than it is on the hierarchy of being. Because in the juxtaposed interrelationship of the creation as a whole, everything has its appropriate place in accordance with its form. Now, that kind of universe is what the problem is. Scotus sees it initially and tries to modify the picture. Occam sees it clearly and rejects the hierarchical picture altogether. Now, how does Scotus modify this? Well, first of all, he tries to affirm what he calls the unicity of being, rather than the analogy of being. And if you're alert to those distinctions between the way in which words could be predicated univocally, analogically, or equivocally, you can see quickly that what he's doing is proposing that the word being should be used univocally of all things, rather than analogically. That is to say, that the word being is such that it refers to simply what is this? Not to degrees of something and degrees of qualities. There may be degrees of goodness, degrees of order, degrees of beauty. But that doesn't mean to say that these are degrees of being, degrees of isness. A thing is or it ain't. It's that simple. And in that sense, for that reason, a being has one and only one meaning. It's not a range of analogical meaning. So the unicity of being. Now, at times, he was misunderstood. In the 17th century, he was misunderstood as talking of the unity of being. Now, to speak of the unity of being is to say that there is only one all-inclusive being, which would be a pantheistic kind of position, which is not what Scotus was asserting. He's very clear about that. But he's not asserting that being is one, that the meaning of, quote, being is one, and not the reference being refers to one and only one being. All inclusive, not the reference of the word being, but the underlying concept of being. You see, the word does not have a variety of analogous meanings, one and only one sense. So, the unicity, or univocity, if you like, of being. Now, in this word, he is breaking the necessity that things be arranged in the particular hierarchy that is and the way they are. They're arranged according to order of goodness, not according to their order of degree of being. And accordingly, the determinism he thinks is broken accordingly. God could have made other creations arranged differently. The creation is contingent in its being and in its order on the way God chose to make it. That does not mean to say that God is completely arbitrary and unthinking. No, he chooses reasonably, but it is dependent on his choice. Now, there's one corollary of this unicity of being. Namely, that God knows things. None through their forms as archetypes in his mind, which he can contemplate and indirectly have an idea of creatures. But God knows beings directly as the kinds of beings they are, because there is no differentiation between beings qua beings. There is one concept, being. And so a direct awareness of all particular beings that he has made. A direct awareness of all particular beings that he has made. Now that business of direct knowledge of particulars, direct knowledge of particular beings, is significant not only because it shows that God is actively involved, makes that intelligible, but because for there to be a direct knowledge of things outside of the divine mind, in contrast to archetypes within the divine mind, for there to be direct knowledge of things outside the divine mind, there must be a kind of mental intentionality. And this word intentionality becomes very significant. We got the notion of intention in the double intention of Thomas's Ethics. But here's the claim that in God's knowing, God engages in an act of intentionality. What is that? An act of external reference, of mentally referring to, mentally pointing out to yourself something external to the mind. Now he sees this in human knowledge as well, and it becomes significant there. And incidentally, that's the kind of intentionality that I assume Dallas Willard's going to be talking about in the Thursday morning Philosophy of Mind seminar. Intentionality is an external reference, an act of the mind, in directly apprehending things external to the mind. Let me pause and have a thought. Part of the development of anti-realism in epistemology in modern times has been due to the fact, and I say part of it, part of it has been due to the fact that knowledge was understood as a byproduct of behavioral stimuli. And that is to say, sense stimuli provoke a change in the state of consciousness, which is a byproduct of those sense stimuli. The mind being simply a passive recipient of such states of consciousness. How then do we know there's something external? And in David Hume, that's why he became saying we couldn't know anything beyond our present experience. Now the other part of the anti-realism is due not to that behaviorist theory of consciousness, but rather to the subjectivity involved, the subjective grids that we bear and superimpose on our consciousness. Now, if there is subjective grid that is brought to bear, then it's likely to reshape the way things would otherwise appear. Do we ever know them as they really are in reality? So in either case, whether because of behaviorism or because of subjectivism, there's a problem of answering the question, how do we know that what we know is real? So if it can be argued that there is a direct awareness of the reality by virtue of a mental act that's able to transcend the limitations of one's own inner consciousness and reach outside, then the affirmation of a knowledge of reality becomes possible. And this is where it is for Scholes. This is the way it was for the Scottish realism of the 18th century. This is the way it was for a lot of 20th century realism. So we'll be watching for this theme of a mental act all along the way. There's a lot of anti-realism in the idealist philosophies of the 19th century. And when the reaction against idealism set in the early 20th century, one of the main arguments against it on the part of some British and American philosophers was in terms of this act of external reference, the mental act of intentionality. Where did they get that idea? They got it from German philosophy, from people like Brentano, who was one of the phenomenologists in the early 20s, along with Edmund Husserl. And when Dallas Willard is here, he's a Husserl specialist. So he brings it straight from the German horse's mouth. So instead of via the British intermediaries. Okay, that's the point. So watch this scotistic emphasis on intentionality, okay, with its direct apprehension, direct awareness of the particulars. All right, now that's the first ingredient in his modification to the Christianized Aristotelianism of Thomas. Second, how do we account for individuality? Now, you recall that again, there's been a variety of positions on this. The tendency in the past has been to say, in the Platonic tradition, that individuality is a privation of form. And since there are various privations of form, there are various individuals, all of them lacking the fullness of their nature in some regard. But that gives no positive value to individuality. And particularly in Judeo-Christian thought rather than Neoplatonic thought, that's a problem. For the Neoplatonists, not so much. They were happy to lose individuality in the mystical world. So the Aristotelian tradition became attractive with its notion that in some way matter individuates. That by virtue of having a space-time location, okay, the embodied form is then individuated by the accidents of that material existence. For Aquinas, that wasn't quite sufficient. Because Aquinas wanted to give positive value to matter because it's something that God created. And you remember, therefore, that Aquinas speaks of matter as pure potency. That is to say, matter has potential for the whole choreographed variety of this creation. Positive value in potential. And that potential is drawn out by virtue of the natures which God combines with matter in the act of creation. So individuality, then, is by act of God drawing out the particular potencies of the matter. Now, Scotus is still not satisfied. It sounds as if matter still individuates. And if matter is what is doing the individuation, whereas rational soul is immaterial, however can immaterial rational soul, when released from the body, be individuated? And furthermore, if God is an immaterial spirit, how can God be individual if matter individuates? So what Scotus proposes is that whereas the form gives the quiditas, that is to say, the whatness of the thing, is provided by the form. It's generic link. What species it is it a member? On the other hand, the individual nature of the thing, its thisness, is provided by a third form, a third kind of principle, other than matter and form. A principle he calls hikaitas. Hikaitas simply being the Latin for thisness. Any of you take Latin here in high school? So a few of you know about hic, hic, hoc, hoc, hanc, hoc, or par, or conjugating the demonstrative pronoun this. Hikaitas, you see, has the hike of the demonstrative pronoun this. Hikaitas is thisness. Thisness. Individuality. This particular person. Not human in general, but this hikaitas. So that the particular is the result not of two principles brought together by God, form and matter, but three principles. Form, matter, and hikaitas. Though he keeps in mind carefully the Aristotelian enjoinder, that these three cannot actually be separated, at least in this life, they always come in composite. In that sense, the distinction is said to be purely form rather than material. A form distinction, one that we make in our thought, rather than three things you can separate out in themselves. So then, individuality is due to the principle thisness. And you have emphasis on individuals whose individual identity is not determined either by form of species or by matter, bodily matter generically. But there is an individualized identity. And it's the hikaitas then that makes possible the freedom of the individual's will. Because the individual's will is not a generic thing. It's not a byproduct of material processes. It's the individual's will. So in those ways, he tries to reinforce the freedom of the will of God in creating by modifying the hierarchical picture. And he tries to reinforce the freedom of the human will by modifying the picture of individuality. Those two things. And with those changes to the underlying metaphysic in mind, then now we can see what he does with the will and intellect issue, which is the source of the whole dispute. Okay. He has a more voluntaristic view of God. He has a more voluntaristic view of human nature. What are the implications? Well, take logic. Take logic. In the case of Aristotelian logic, you remember how Aristotle, developed the syllogism, but drew our attention that with such to the fact that with such demonstrative reasoning, The big problem we have is of establishing the first premises, the first principles from which syllogistic reasoning proceeds. And you recall how, according to Aristotle, one gains knowledge of those first principles. That is to say, by abstracting the first principle of the species from your cumulative experience of the whole species. So, according to Aristotle, you can have assured knowledge by means of this intuitive abstraction. You can have assured knowledge of first principles and engage in deductive demonstrative reasoning. Run the syllogisms. If you know the first principles of the species, you can infer all sorts of other things that follow concerning members of the species, individuals of the species. All men are mortal. Socrates is a man. Then you know he is getter. As they did in Athens, they got him. Now, the problem that Scotus sees, is with this claim that first principles for logical demonstration are that readily accessible. And the reason for that is that in a world where individuals are what they are because of hikaiotas, thisness, the distinction between species may not be always that clear. At the best, we would have some probability only concerning the nature of the species, so that your syllogistic arguments would never lead you to logical certainty, but only to varying degrees of probability. Accordingly, natural theology, if possible, will lead only to certain probabilities limited by the nature of the premise. But he is not unduly alarmed at that, because if we have a direct knowledge of particular things, then we're able to examine particular things as particulars more carefully and find similarities. And so the probability of that kind of examination of particulars is available to in establishing first premises. So in logic, the implication is that arguments yield only probability. If they only yield probability, then the act of believing something, or the act of judging something to be true, or judging something to be morally good or bad, takes an act of will, not just intellect. And so belief is seen as an act of will. Moral judgment is an act of will. A truth judgment is an act of will that we can be responsible for. The act of will. Now, the implications then flow from logic into epistemology. Abstraction of sorts is possible, yes, not as definitely, but it is aided by the intentionality of reference to particulars, aided by that direct mental act of external reference, in which we assent to something or deny it, aided also by divine illumination. And Scotus draws more explicitly on the Aristotelian tradition that emphasizes the way in which the divine light lightens the mind in its understanding of truth. But perhaps the more far-reaching implication comes in ethics. If the creation is contingent, in what it is, on the will of God, rather than being logically necessary as it is, that is going to have an effect on natural law ethics. Because the natural law ethic is saying that by virtue of the essential nature of things as they are a necessity, by virtue of form, universal, there is a common inbred, common built-in tendency, inclination, direction, which can be read from the nature of things, indicating the natural moral law. And we were talking about that at the end of the hour. But if Scotus is correct, that kind of natural law is, well, let's say, just a prima facie obligation. Because if the creation is contingent on the will of God, then God might, as things change, will something different. And so Scotus allows for possible changes in the nature of moral law. He takes, for instance, as an example, the Ten Commandments, which Thomas had seen as an example of natural moral law, which is simply re-promulgated in divine law given in Scripture. And incidentally, that way of seeing the Decalogue is very common. It's true of Thomas, it's true of Scotus, it's true of John Calvin, true of Martin Luther, with an adumbrated notion of natural moral law, even. The Decalogue is seen as representative of that natural moral law. But according to Scotus, the first three commandments, thou shalt have no other gods before me, not make graven images, bow down, worship them, not take the Lord's name in vain. Those first three commandments have to do with our relationship to God, who is unchanging. And because God is unchanging, those first three commandments are unchanging. But the last seven commandments are about relationship to created things, created beings, other humans, in changing situations involving changing particular beings. So it is conceivable, he says, that those commandments might change in the course of history or in particular cases. Why, for instance, in the Old Testament did God seem to allow polygamy? Why could he ask Abraham to sacrifice his only son, Isaac? How could he tell Hosea to marry a harlot? And so on. So what Scotus comes out with is not saying that it's all up to grabs, but saying basically our ethic depends on divine will, divine command. Doesn't depend on the nature of things, because the nature of things is not necessary. It depends on divine command. And so his is a clear case of what nowadays we call divine command theory as to the grounds of an ethic, a divine command theory. But so far as the divine command leaves us with no change given to the natural law, Ten Commandments, that holds. That holds. And if we're dealing with matter in which the natural law or the divine commands are both silent, then, says Scotus, we have to appeal to right reason. Right reason. That right reason tends to be prudential. Well, that is to say, weighing the consequences of actions and policies. And while he doesn't develop that at great length, it's that which becomes the cue for William of Ockham, Martin Luther, Thomas Hobbes, and on the influence of the nominalism of the late part of the Middle Ages on Americans. So Scotus then is modifying the Thomistic modification of Aristotle to avoid deterministic implications concerning God, concerning human nature, and the resultant unchanging necessity of the creation and natural world. Okay, let me pause there for a question.
In Aquinas, for generations back, it said that we could form matter and privation. And in Scotus, is he replacing privation with
I don't know of a passage where he talks about that. The same that in Aquinas, the three things needed for generation are matter, which is privation, and which is potency. Matter, form, and privation. Yeah, still in a state of potency, of course. Those three things are necessary. Is he denying some of this? Is that the question?
Yeah, he doesn't ever seem to talk about privation.
No, he talks about matter and form and hypeitas, but I think in terms of the overall picture, we have to say privation. If you're talking of any process of becoming, any process of change, then what is going to change has to be suffering from privation in regards to that to which it is changing. Oh, you couldn't have changed.
Yeah, so maybe he just thinks that
is this tautological, so that it's included in that earlier picture? And so it gets sort of bracketed in emphasizing this as
What would Scotus say about the nature of evil then? There's no sense that kind of rules out that some beings are less, by the virtue of the fact that they have less beings, they're more.
I'm not sure that it changes that picture. You see, to say that evil is privation of good would still hold. It's not going to be privation of being, let's say, because it is relent. But it's going to be privation of good, perhaps privation of form, perhaps privation of the intended high care path. You're not the man you follow. But it would still be privation.
Where does the high chaos come from? Does God create that directly?
Yes.
So that individual existing being is directly from God?
Yes. God has direct knowledge of every particular and directly creates every particular, every individual.
But
is he God?
So how did he create an evil being?
Has he created an evil being? Or has he created beings who now suffer from privation? And I take it, in your mind, you are mulling over, Yeah, after all, Adam created the sun, so. Yeah. So I think he handles this pretty well. To this day, I think it's fair to say that the people in the Dominican tradition, Jesuits and so forth, tend to favor Aquinas, their tradition. In the Franciscan tradition, tend to favor Scotus. It's more of the Augustinian. And so if you want to see the philosophical difference between those two Catholic orders, then it's really Thomas and Scotus. Though, again, it has to be said that since Vatican II, a lot's changed there, too. That was clear.
I'm interested in his picture of God. You said that he maintains a hierarchy of goodness, so there's not a problem in that mind. Ethical structure, but he's destroying the hierarchy of being. I'm confused about where God fits in as far as the metaphysics is concerned, particularly with regard to the goodness of God.
You see, God, like every other being, is a being. But God is not the totality of being. God is not being itself. He is a being and the creator of other beings. That's saying that God is different in essence, even though there is a unifical being. God is all powerful. God is perfectly good, so on and so forth. So, what you have in that sense is a, well, it's not as systematically and detailed a metaphysical picture as Thomas gives, you see. But it is in another sense, because every individual has its own identity, is known directly by God, you see, has its own worth. But God is a being, supreme being. Yeah. Quality, but a being. So that when you say that God exists, you're using the word exists in exactly the same sense as when you say that David sues. Though when you say God is good, you're certainly using it in a fascinating sense when you say David sins. Outside the divine mind is confusing. I don't know about my phrase. If God knows it, then he knows something in his mind. But in his mind, he knows about something that's outside. Don't you? I mean, in your mind now, you're thinking about what I just said. What was said was outside your mind. Now, the question is whether you know what is outside your mind directly or only through the intermediacy of ideas. You see, and according to Aristotle, we know things through the intellectual species abstracted from the sensible species. That is to say, through our ideas. In the Platonic tradition, God would know things only through the archetypal ideas. Well, the question is, do we just have ideas and then try to infer that something particular exists to correspond to it? Are we in a direct domain? As they are. And what Thomas is asserting is that the mind, God's mind, human mind, very nature of mentality, the mind is able, as it were, to extend its mental grasp to see the far beyond. Now, you know, visually, that's, I like to say, easy. I might say I have my eyes on somebody back there. My eyes on, my eyes are here. But you see, in sense experience, I'm able to give attention to something way over there. Watch it. And the same is true with other senses beside the eyes, although the eyes are most clearly tuned. You do it with your ears. Now, where does that sound come from? You see, you try to get your direction finding. Because you're trying to identify directly that which is out there. That this act of external reference, intentionality means a mental point, act of the firm, a meaning. That's what I mean. Awesome.
What is that?
No, I don't think it's saying that God doesn't, but he isn't shut into it. That's to say, God can think of the essence of humanness as a species, but he can also think particularly of Christian Quintilia as an individual. Which I suspect you find rather encouraging.
But it seems as if he had created those individuals, then those archetypes would also be his mind.
He's not saying that, not. But there's a difference between their being in your mind and not being able to contemplate anything of the other. That is to say, you have several alternatives. One, you have the mind contemplating the archetype within the mind. You have the mind contemplating the archetype and referring to then some particular out there. Or alternatively, you have the mind that contemplates the archetype, that contemplates the particular, and does that referring back to the archetype. So what you have is this immediate thought. You've got this intentional awareness, and in terms of one of the people who developed this in the 20th century was George Santayana, who taught at Harvard in the 20s, 30s. Santayana made the distinction this way between perception in the mode of causal efficacy, when I'm simply caused to have a sense stimulus, and causation in the mode of presentational means, when the mind just contemplates its own contents. Now, what's involved in causal efficacy? See, he's talking of human perception. What's involved in causal efficacy is a stimulus-response mechanism between the object and the consciousness, stimulating consciousness, which therefore reflexes back in an act of reference to the source of stimulus. Direct. And only when that is accomplished, as a general rule, do we start asking ourselves, now what is this object? And then the idea of the presentation or immediacy. Is it a man or is it a monkey? What is it? You're considering that. That's why you can wake up in the night and say hello to the arm. You mistakenly conceive what that external object is, whose existence you are immediately aware of. So this is the thing that's getting. We think of particulars in terms of our ideas. God thinks of them in terms of his archetypal ideas. But he thinks of them, not just of the archetypal ideas.
I'm still a little foggy on the difference between human intellectualism and human voluntarism.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the real distinction.
Well, yeah, the thing is that Scotus reads Aquinas as saying that because the intellect perceives X to be good, it therefore naturally, read necessarily, seeks that good X. And there's no choice. You see, and there are places where Aquinas seems to be saying, yes, the intellect determines what we seek, the will determines how we seek, by what means. Well, Scotus wants will as the determinative, the critical thing, in both cases, in these both. Is this a misreading of Aquinas?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. But remember, before the printing press, it was very easy to misread something. And you hadn't read. But you'd heard. You may not have been fortunate enough to hear, to talk, to get hold of magazines. Some comments about William of Ockham before we're through, with introductory. We'll come back to this on Friday if we need to. But the thing that I want to emphasize here is plainly his determinism. The critique of realism extends from Scotus, and we'll come back to that. But William of Ockham, in his rejection of real universes, develops a kind of nominalist position. It's best known as determinism to avoid confusion with the nominalism of Rosselin, who we mentioned earlier when we were introducing the problem of universals. Rosselin had simply maintained that only words have anything universal about them. Words have universal reference. The word dog refers to the whole species of dogs and to every individual canine specimen. Only words have anything universal. There are no real universals. There are no universal concepts like doghood, dogness. There are just words that have universal reference to a whole class of things. And that was as far as Rosselin went, and he only went that far because he was embroiled in a metaphysical dispute. What is there in reality that is universal? None. No things, no concepts, only words, and really they are particular words with universal reference. Now, when you come to William of Ockham, he lays emphasis on words, terms, yes. But his interest is less on the metaphysical question and more on logical questions. Logical questions because of those problems with Aristotle's logic, which Scotus mentioned. But in the determinism of Ockham, you see, the term, somehow or other, stands for a whole array, a whole variety of individuals. How can that be? How can one word have universal reference? Well, you'll find in the reading that our editor distinguishes between two views. Occam's first view and Occam's second view. Occam's first view is that the term that has universal reference, the term brings with it an image, a particular mental image, which is our mental picture indiscriminately of the whole class of individuals. So if we're talking of the term human, then that term refers without any differentiating qualities to our mental picture of all individuals. It's going to be a very, very vague thing. Not much more than a stick person. Not going to be much more than that. Human being. Very vague image. But he wasn't happy with that. Because it implied that if the term refers to an image or an idea, a particular idea of very vague sort, then our knowledge of those particulars is indirect by means of the ideas. And following Scotus, he wants to emphasize direct awareness. So his second view avoids this playing around with mental ideas we may have, but we have a direct awareness of individuals and a whole class of things. And in that sense, the term refers not to a representative idea, but rather to the mental act, of referring, of intentional reference. So when I say human being, I'm not just using a word which is a symbol for an idea. When I say human being, I'm engaging in an act of referring, mental reference. I'm pointing to every one of you and every other one I have seen or shall see. The mental act. And because the mental act has that external reference, consequently, the term is not simply a term for a particular range. It's a term used to refer, to point, mentally, the mental act rather than the mental image. So that's the way in which he develops it. And that has far-reaching ramifications. As a terminist, a nominalist, he is rejecting all real universals. And if he's rejecting all universals, then he's rejecting the whole hierarchical structure of the medieval philosophy. The most radical change. There is no longer the logos theology with archetypal ideas in the mind of the logos. This is no longer the best of all possible worlds, this choreographed creation. It's no longer something which in all of its integral parts is a necessary whole, it images the divine goodness. No. No. Instead of a teleological worldview, what Occam has, essentially, is a mechanistic worldview in line with the science which is beginning to emerge in the 14th century. Because without formal causes, universals, there are no inbuilt final causes. All you're left with is material causes, bodies, efficient causes, forces. Which is precisely what the mechanistic science of the scientific revolution picked up. So, without universals, he's going to have to be much more empirical in his study of particulars. Without universals, his worldview is going to be mechanistic rather than teleological. And so William of Ockham opens the doors to the new science, and the result is essentially the disintegration of the medieval synthesis. Get the picture? Well, that's the picture that I'm hoping Dallas Willard will help us with next time. and in any case, I want to develop.